Good morning, everyone. Just to let you know, there is extra seating downstairs. We do have a screen where you can see and hear the service. So for those of you who are standing or just making your way into the coat check area, you can go downstairs if you wish. And I also remind you, if you haven't already, please turn your cell phones off or to silent. And at this point, I will invite you to please rise for our processional hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness. I am resurrection and I am life, says the Lord. Whoever has faith in me shall have life even though he die. And everyone who has life and is committed to me in faith shall not die forever. Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And when I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am you may be also. I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. I invite you to please be seated. Welcome to all of you, and thank you for coming here this morning and gathering as we remember the life of Abraham Millar today, also known as Pete. Before we begin, once again, for those who have just come in the last few moments, there is extra seating downstairs in our basement. You will be able to see and hear the service on our screens downstairs, and the facilities are downstairs as well. Everything you will need for the service today you can find in two places in the wonderful booklet that has been prepared for you. All of the lyrics to the hymns and the readings and everything is in that booklet and also on the screen. So you have two places that you can look for the service today. The family has asked me before we begin the service to share with you the information that following our service here at the church this morning, we'll be making our way to Glenview Memorial Gardens for the interment. If you would like directions there, please speak to the funeral home staff. They made us aware again this morning that Goreway is closed here, so we will be going down to Derry, making the right, going up Airport Road to then make the right on Steele. So you can come in behind the procession if you wish to go to the cemetery, but if you're making your own way there and you need directions, please just speak to them before you leave. I'm honored to be here today as we gather to mourn the loss of a loved one, to comfort and support each other in a time of need, and to commemorate Abraham's life. I'm sure today that there will be many a fond memory recalled with a smile, as well as some laughter and some tears. I did not have the pleasure of knowing Abraham well in this life, but seeing the turnout last night at the visitation, looking around here today at a packed church and overflow seating downstairs, I know he touched the lives of many. There will be many memories shared. The care of love and family and friends that he exuded in this life will come out in the stories we hear and in the thoughts of all of you today. I've heard from so many members of the family and members of the parish in the time since Abraham's passing about his care for family, for friends, and for the community, and for his steadfast faith. And again, you are all tribute to that and to his life today. And I'm looking forward to hearing more about him, his adventures, and his life in the tributes and the eulogy that we hear during this service. We have many wonderful passages of scripture that will be shared today, many words of promise and hope in our hymns as well that were chosen by the family and are so beautiful, timeless hymns and readings that will speak to the center of our faith. One reading that is not included today but which is often used at funerals and memorial services is from the book of the Wisdom of Solomon. It has the famous line, "The souls of the righteous are in the hands of God." What better place could we go after death than into the hands of God our Creator? What a beautiful way to describe God's care for all of us. When we were small children, our loved ones, our parents, would take us up into their arms in times where we needed care, where we needed to feel safety and security. When we die, God does that for us. We are taken up into our Heavenly Father's hands. And that peace and security and safety that we would feel in a moment of fear and anxiety or sadness as children, well, that peace and security is forever with our Heavenly Father. A few moments ago, in those opening sentences, I shared with you that famous passage of Jesus saying that he goes to prepare a place for all of us. We are all sons and daughters of God. We are all welcomed into his bosom and into those arms that will keep us safe. Today, we believe that Abraham is in God's hands. That passage from the Wisdom of Solomon goes on to say that to those without faith, death seems to be the end. It seems to be destruction and the end of all we know. But we know that that's not the case at all. Just this past Sunday on Easter Day, we celebrated the empty tomb. We celebrated the victory of our Lord Jesus Christ over death and the grave. And as Christians, we are Easter people, or as we are often described, we are people of the resurrection, people of new life. And although we unfortunately still do have to gather like this in pain and in sorrow at separation and death, we know that the gate of death is not the end. Even though we grieve, we don't do it as people without hope. We know the promises of Christ. That passage from the Wisdom of Solomon goes on to say, they who trust in him will understand the truth. Those who are faithful will live with him in love, for grace and mercy await those whom he has chosen. That is the hope and the peace that stands at the center of our Christian faith. That is the love and the joy of which Abraham has now found a place in glory with his heavenly Father. Thanks be to God. Amen. There's a collect prayer which is said at all of our Anglican funerals and memorial services. I will share that prayer with you now. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. God of all consolation, in your unending love and mercy, you turn the darkness of death into the dawn of new life. Show compassion to your people in their sorrow. Be our refuge and our strength to lift us from the darkness of grief into the peace and light of your presence. Your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by dying for us, conquered death, and by rising again, restored life. May we then go forward eagerly to meet him, and after our life on earth, be reunited with our brothers and sisters, where every tear will be wiped away. We ask this through Jesus Christ the Lord. Amen. And at this time, we will have our first tribute and scripture reading. Again, you will find the scripture reading in your booklet. I invite those who will be reading to come forward. For all of those reading and giving tributes today, the lectern mic is there in case you have notes. It's a better microphone.
Well, hi, everyone. For those who might not know me, I'm Jamil, Pete's granddaughter, and Stephen's daughter. We're here to share a few words and readings in honor of our granddad. And I'm here alongside my cousin Zoe and my sister Drea. We were fortunate to grow up in a house that truly felt like home, where we shared sleepovers and created memories that now define our sense of nostalgia in adulthood. This nostalgia feels even stronger in the absence of our granddad, who's integral to these memories that remain cherished in our hearts and through photos and stories. Granddad's presence was a constant in our lives, a gentle and kind soul whose joy lit up his face and could fill a room with his bright energy and laughter. whether lost in introspection by the window or enjoying music from a Barbados radio station, he was always welcoming in the front room on Dwiggan Ave. Whenever I entered the house, I would go search to find him in a few common places, his face brightening with happiness at the sight of me. His excitement mirrored mine as he greeted me with, and I won't do this justice, but with an enthusiastic, "Oh, Jammy!" He'd pretty well sing it. A now treasured memory of his voice and the simple joy of making him proud just by being there. His pride in me taught me the impact of simply being there for someone. It doesn't have to take much. As I grew older and started driving, I would surprise him with visits, anticipating the joy it would bring him and how it would bring me back to my childhood. Despite the passing years, his caring nature never wavered, offering reassurance with a "just hang in there" and advice like his rule number one of "pay yourself first." He may have mentioned other things about saving, not just spending, but rule number one is my favorite. And seriously, it is because he explained it in a way that made the lesson, "be sure to take care of yourself." Our conversations continued through channels like WhatsApp, preserving and archiving our connection forever. His messages, always timely, are now cherished reminders of his presence in our lives. And although I'm the one speaking these words right now, they reflect the sentiments of all of us, Pete Miller's grandchildren. Let the pictures serve as evidence. Zoe, Jordan, Drea, Aiden, Avery, and baby Kiara. In every photo with Granddad, we radiate the joy we've been privileged to share as part of his 92-year-long journey. Without a doubt, Granddad's presence has brought us immense comfort and warmth, leaving an everlasting imprint on our hearts. Granddad, being your granddaughter will always be one of the most cherished things I get to be in this lifetime. Thank you for everything, and rest well. Passing things to Zoe.
So I'm Zoe. I'm the daughter of Terry and Dawn. I prepared, and it's just now that I actually have to do it, it's so hard. Okay. I was very privileged to have my grandfather in my life for 32 years. Despite all of the changes that came my way, one of the things that remained constant was his constant supportive spirit. When I think about the times I spent with Granddad, one of my core memories is when I was in grade 2 and he would walk me home from the bus stop and spend time helping me with my French homework. I remember being in awe because I thought I was the only one who spoke French. And to this day, his rhyme still replays in my head like a chant. Bijou, caillou, chou, genou, ibou, juju, pou. Looking back, I'm pretty sure what made it stick was the fact that he said poo, but it worked. Later on, as Jamil recounted, we would spend a lot of time at the Dwiggan house, sleeping over, messing around on the computer upstairs, playing polo in the backyard, or staying up late and watching the news with Grandma and Granddad. As life would have it, I would move away and spend a lot of time traveling, and travel is actually what brought me and my granddad closer together. No matter where I was, he would always ask me if I made it to my destination, what the weather was like, what sights I had seen. We would constantly exchange photos, and although he was a generally quiet man, he never had an issue chatting away via WhatsApp. After listening to Jamil's tribute, I noticed a parallel in some of the advice our granddad shared. At times, I would feel guilty about being so far away, sometimes missing his birthday or special family occasions. He would reassure me that I was missed, but it was okay because one has to do what's in their best interest. His advice of taking care of yourself first is something that I continue to try to live by. And I could always be at peace knowing that no matter the distance, I had his unconditional love and support. It's going to be an adjustment going back to the house and not immediately going to greet Granddad in the front room and catch him up on all of the exciting details of my life. But there are so many memories and moments that I'm grateful for and will get to relive one day when I share these stories with my daughter. I will now read from 2 Corinthians 4, verses 16 to 18, and end with a poem that captures our sentiments towards our granddad so well. Therefore, we do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen, since what is seen is temporary and what is unseen is eternal. You're thought about so often in loving memory, for you were all the special things a granddad ought to be. We've all missed you being here since you went away, but the happiness you brought us is remembered every day. So may you find a gentle peace in your eternal rest. We'll always love you, Granddad. You really were the best. And now I will hand it over to Drea, who will read from Psalm 23.
So Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. He makes me, He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
All right, I didn't prepare a tribute like them, but I'll still say a few words. Like, my granddad was a great man, simple. He didn't say too much. He guided me. You know, I asked him a lot of questions towards the end of his life, just because I was curious about like what he came from and what got him to where he is today. Because that takes a lot of risk to come from overseas, come here, start a life, and raise three kids and have grandkids and things of that nature. So I'm going to read the second Bible reading, Psalm 46, right now. God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth give away and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam and the mountains quake with their surging. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy place where the Most High dwells. God is within her, she will not fail. God will help her at break of day. Nations are in uproar, kingdoms fall. He lifts his voice, the earth melts. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come and see what the Lord has done, the desolations he has brought on the earth. He makes wars cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the shield with fire. He says, Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted amongst the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress.
If you are able, I invite you to please rise for our next hymn, Precious Lord, Take My Hand. Be seated for our third Bible reading.
Hi, everyone. My name is Dawn Millar, daughter-in-law of Abraham Millar and wife of Terry Millar. I'll be reading from Psalm 90, a psalm of Moses. And it says, Lord, you have been our dwelling place throughout all the generations. Before the mountains were ever born, or you brought forth the old world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. You turn people back to dust, saying, return to dust, you mortals. 1,000 years in your sight are like a day that has just gone by, or like are like a watch in the night, yet you sweep people away in the sleep of death. They are like the new grass of the morning. In the morning, it springs up new, but by evening, it is dried and withered. We are consumed by your anger and terrified by your indignation. You have set our iniquity before you, our secret sins in the light of your presence. All our days passed away under your wrath, and you finish your years with a moan. Our days may come to 70 years or 80 if our strength endures. Yet the best of them are but trouble and sorrow, for they are quickly past and we fly away. If only we know the power of your anger. Your wrath is as great as the fear that is due. Teach us to number our days, that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Relent, Lord. How long will it be? Have compassion on your servants. Satisfy us in the morning with your unfailing love, that we may sing for joy and be glad all our days. Make us glad for all as many days as we have afflicted us, as you have afflicted us, for as many years as we have seen trouble. May our deeds be shown by your servant and your splendor to their children. May the favor of the Lord our God rest on us. Establish the work of our hands for us. Yes, establish the works of our hand. And this is the reading of God's word. Thank you.
A blessed morning to everyone. Before I begin, I want to just convey the condolences of my brother, my oldest brother, who is not here. He asked that I convey the condolences of his wife and himself to the family here. My other brother, James, also asked to apologize on his behalf. He had another engagement. He was already booked to go to Jamaica. Where he is at the moment, he asks to convey his apology to the family and also his condolences as well. What I will share is a compilation of tributes from my other siblings, the nieces of Uncle Pete. His Uncle Pete's niece, Lorraine, says, "I can actually see Uncle Pete's ready smile and hear his hearty laughter. Uncle was a very pleasant and engaging person, and no words can fully describe the special characteristics of love and devotion for our family. He shared many beautiful moments talking to all of us, whenever he called to speak to Dad." I think, by the way, his brother, our father, I think today's his birthday, right? So there's a connection there, right? "Those calls were long and humorous, and sometimes serious. He inquired of our well-being, progress, and made suggestions too. You could speak with him on any subject matter. He always sent us monetary gifts at Christmas. Everyone would receive a small brown envelope with their name on it, and that made us so happy. It was like Santa Claus came to town. Rest in peace, Uncle. You truly were a wonderful soul, a shining example, and your memories will never be forgotten, forever in our hearts. That's Lorraine's tribute. I say, Uncle Pete, that's the name that I associated with my uncle who resided in Canada. There was always an air of excitement whenever we were informed that Pete was visiting Barbados. We look forward to him sharing a meal with the family and also driving to a picnic spot on the island. He always seemed to be optimistic, engaging, and charming. He would inquire about everyone. He was very jovial and enjoyed a hearty laugh or joke. He would often reminisce about life in Orange Hill, St. James, and in Barbados in general. He had a good memory, often recalling persons by name or nicknames. My siblings and I appreciated the many gifts or parcels which he gave during our childhood. Dawn and I remembered his visit to our home. We were also able to visit him and Dorothy at their home. We will treasure the precious memories of you, Uncle. Rest in peace. Debbie reflects by saying, you can never say a few words and think that be the end of the convo with Uncle Pete. His sons are chuckling. There would always be a rebuttal, a word of encouragement, or the offering of another perspective, which invariably led to a longer conversation. And if at all his legs were crossed, boy oh boy, then you were locked in for the long haul. Uncle had a warmness about him and was very easygoing. His distinct chuckle will surely be missed. So now I get to use your parting words. So long. Rest in eternal peace and love, Uncle. Until next time, cheers. Love always, Debbie. Paulette's tribute. Uncle Pete was always a joy to be around. What I remembered most was his hearty laughter and long conversations. He was like my second dad, always in tune with your development and would advise you on what to do as well. Uncle Pete would always tell Dad what you say, so you better be careful what you tell Uncle. Every year, without fail, around Christmas, look out for a money envelope from Uncle Pete. Although I am grown, those envelopes were still coming. I've already prepared myself mentally not to look for Uncle's envelope. I am going to miss you dearly, Uncle Pete. I pray that the angels will look after you and keep you in God's care. Until we meet again, rest now, Uncle. R.I.P. Rest in peace and rise in glory. Your niece, Paulette. James's tribute. Uncle Pete, pleasant, entertaining, talkative, endearing. Quote unquote. 5 minutes more. Uncle Pete, he saved the day for me. The occasion was one of our family outings when Uncle Pete and family were visiting from Canada. It was at Farley Hill National Park where we had stopped to relax and grab a bite. Being the explorer that I was and still am, I decided to venture into the woods, unknown to anyone else. As I approached the entrance to the woods, there was a sign stating clearly and warning persons not to go into the woods. This is James speaking. Being somewhat foolhardy, that's upon reflection now, I went to the other entrance to the woods. And guess what? There was no warning sign. So I figured, well, this gives me the green light to proceed. I ventured into the woods, trying to create landmarks to assist me on my return journey. However, on that return journey, I encountered a Y junction and could not figure out whether to go left or to go right. Anyhow, I chose one, only to end up on a main road. And having no clue whatsoever where I was, I turned back and returned to the Y junction and followed the other route. After walking for a while and not recognizing anything familiar, and of course, beginning to think worst case scenario, it entered into my heart to pray. First, to confess my disobedience, and then ask the Lord to deliver me out of the woods. And believe it or not, folks, when I opened my eyes, right there, ahead of me, in the distance, was the back of the sign which I had seen at the beginning. I just had to give God thanks. When I eventually got back to the car park, I realized that everything was packed up and everyone was ready to go. I was told that a search for me was made. Persons were calling, hollering for me, but to no avail. I was so deep in those woods, I never heard a sound. After a while, it was decided to proceed without me. Then it was, so I was told, that Uncle Pete spoke up and said, 5 more minutes. And it was within those 5 minutes that I appeared. Thank you, Uncle Pete, for those 5 more minutes. I have lived to tell the tale. To God be the glory. P.S. I am now ready to venture into those woods again. Any one game? That's James. Now, Margaret's memory, in loving memory of her uncle, of Uncle Pete. Our beloved Uncle Pete was always a joy to be around. Excitement always filled the air whenever we heard he was coming to Barbados. You know, you're hearing some things here over and over again. We can tell stories of his kindness, warmth, and unyielding devotion to his late brothers. He was a man of action, always on the move, always able to locate and visit his boyhood friends whenever he visited Barbados. When we visited Canada, he would take us to Niagara Falls, and on another occasion, spend time with some Bajan friends and travel back home in a snowstorm. What a chilling experience, no pun intended. With a heart as vast as the open sky, Uncle Pete embodied generosity in its purest form. His spirit knew no bounds when it came to giving, whether it was a brown envelope with some Canadian dollars or 2 parcels at Christmas time that he and Dorothy put together for us. These brown envelopes went on to his great nieces and nephews as well. But it wasn't just his generosity that made Uncle Pete remarkable. It was his ability to engage in conversations that enlivened any space that he occupied. He was a talker. He would always inquire about our progress academically and professionally and encourage us to aim high. He was a walking history book of the good old days in Orange Hill, and he had a gift for weaving narratives that captivated hearts and stirred souls with laughter. Yet, perhaps, his most cherished role was that of a devoted brother to our late dad, Lawrence.
Good morning. Perhaps his most cherished role was that of a devoted brother to our late dad, Lawrence, and our uncle, Belfield. Their bond was expressed by exchanging cards at Christmas time, and not even COVID lockdowns interrupted that, because instead of resorting to digital cards, both of them independently had respective children looking for physical cards and only feeling satisfied when they were mailed and received and reported upon receipt. This would be through one of many lengthy phone calls, and is a testament to strong family ties. Through life's triumphs, they stood shoulder to shoulder, offering each other unwavering support and love. In Uncle Pete, my granddad, found not only a brother, but a confidant, a mentor, and a lifelong friend. Though Uncle Pete may have left his earthly realm, his spirit continues to shimmer in the memories we hold dear. His generosity, his eloquence, and his devotion to family serve as guiding lights, illuminating our paths even in the darkest of times. As we gather to honor his legacy, let us carry forward his legacy of kindness, his love of conversation, and his unwavering commitment to those he held dear. Uncle Pete, your light will forever burn bright in our hearts, a beacon of love and inspiration, guiding us through life's journey. Though you may no longer walk among us, your spirit remains ever present, a cherished memory we hold close to until we meet again. Rest in peace, dear uncle, knowing your legacy of love lives on in the lives you touch so profoundly. We love you dearly. And then there's a little poem. Uncle, of all the many blessings, however great or small, to have had you for our uncle was the greatest one of all. The family chain is broken now, and nothing seems the same. But as God takes us one by one, the chain will link again.
Check, check, check. Okay, I was wondering if I should say good morning or good afternoon, but it's morning. Well, 5 more minutes. How about that? Thank you. Okay, what made me decide to do this? The song I'm gonna sing is probably about two or three years old. But what I realized is that the third time I heard it, I was always thinking about my dad. It just seemed like that was the thought. So I would sing, I would hear it on the radio, and suddenly dad comes to mind. And as much as I didn't want to go there, I knew I was going to be here to do this song. It had to be. So bear with me, because I don't do this for a living. We gotta thank Jordan for being here. Jordan, my son, for being here. He's gonna help me on the bass. And we'll see how it goes. And if you know the song, or if you know any parts of the song, sing along to what you know, okay?
It's running after me. Your goodness is running after. It's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I'll give you everything. Your goodness is running after. It's running after me. All my life you have been faithful. 'Cause all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I will sing, all my life you have been faithful, 'cause all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will of the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I'd like to call up my brothers now. We're going to do this thing. That's his. Okay, I'll just stay over here. I'm good.
Oh, you're good.
Okay, once again, let me put this down. I don't need this. Oh, sorry. Oh boy. Okay, let's get to it. Okay, thank you everybody for coming and just being a part. Okay, we thank you. This is my brother's here, Mike, Steve, and I'm Terry. And again, we thank you for coming today, whether in person or virtually, to honor and celebrate the extraordinary life of my father, Abraham Millar, alongside my brothers, Michael and Stephen. And I'm deeply touched by your presence as we bid farewell to our beloved dad, affectionately known as Pete. That's it. That's right. Abraham Millar's journey began on March 26th of 1931 in Orange Hill, St. James, Barbados. And he was welcomed into the world by Simeon, a masterful carpenter, and Eloise, a nurturing homemaker who lovingly maintained order in the household. Dad often delighted us with stories from his childhood, recounting adventures with his brothers, Lawrence and Belfield. Together, they shouldered responsibilities like tending to livestock and fetching water from the pipe before leaving for school each day. Dad would chuckle as he recalled Lawrence's vehicle, a Morris Minor, which served as a minibus. Dad played a pivotal role in this venture, collecting passenger fares and gaining an intimate knowledge of the island's district. Okay. Yep.
I was going second. In 1956, at the age of 25, Dad summoned the courage to seek brighter horizons abroad, setting his sights on England for enhanced educational and employment opportunities. His journey from Barbados to England was not a small feat. He traveled a long way by ship, stopping at ports in St. Lucia, Dominica, Guadeloupe, Spain, and Italy, before continuing on a train through Switzerland to France, eventually arriving in England. Despite having to deal with the bitter cold and the dampness, that constant that was different than his tropical homeland, Dad persisted, fueled by a determination to succeed. But when he used to tell us the stories about that, he said if he had the money, he'd go right back home. Once he reached London, he was warmly embraced by one of his friends, George Payne, who have paved the way for Dad's arrival, securing him accommodation at 10 King's College Road. Here began Dad's new chapter, laying the groundwork for a life teeming with opportunity and adventure. Eventually, Dad moved to a new place, sharing a home with some other friends who were like him, had embarked on the journey from Barbados. Among them was David Applewhite, which they fondly called Apple, Larry Williams, which they called Andy Cap, Roy Nichols, who they called Roy Nick, Clive Spencer. They're called Spence. I should get a nickname. who became long life friends. Dad enrolled in school for laboratory sciences, simultaneously juggling a multitude of jobs to subsidize his tuition and everyday living expenses. It was during that time that he found his life partner and married Dorothy Payne, with whom he built a family and raised these three men above before you. In the mid-60s, they made the bold decision to relocate to Canada, arriving in Montreal, and from there, they embarked on an overnight train journey to Toronto on July 1st, 1965. Or as my dad would tell us a story repeatedly, back then it was called Dominion Day. His friends Velda and Felix Beckles graciously assisted them in setting them up in their new home. Soon after arriving,
he's just getting you back.
Youngest kid. Soon after arriving, Dad secured a job in Canada as a water quality lab technician, which would eventually move to the Ministry of Environment, where he dedicated 28 years of his life before retiring. During this time, the family moved from downtown Toronto to North York, and finally here in Malton. You know, all the time while, you know, we were doing our sports, and he was actively involved in all of the sports and what we did for Boy Scouts and going to all our parent-teacher interviews because he really liked academics for some reason. Our home was always a hub for warmth and hospitality. Whether it was our friends or their friends, they were always welcome. You know, Dad and Mom always found joy in seeing the others being happy. They knew how to throw a good party, and Dad was quite the smooth dancer in his early years. Despite the noise of Terry practicing with his band, right? And, you know, Steve and I playing loud music and breakdancing in the garage all the time, they never complained, and he always supported our passions, right? Always eager to share his wealth, as once said, Dad had a knack for turning any conversation into a learning opportunity. For instance, the mere mention of planning a trip, Dad would swiftly produce a Purley's map, guiding each of us with precision to exactly how to reach their destination. You know, his readiness to impart information on various products, topics, reflected his generous spirit. Some of Dad's happiest moments were spent with his six grandchildren: Zoe, Jordan, Drea, Jameel, Aiden, and Avery, and his one grandchild, Kiara.
Great.
He was always, great.
Yeah, that's it.
That's why I was going to read.
Where was I?
He was.
So our dad, he's always smiling, never complaining, even on the days that he wasn't feeling his best. But all the time, Dad was a sharp dresser. You rarely saw him without a button-up shirt or dress pants. I never forget, actually, down the street where I played baseball, we had games against the parents, right? My dad was on the parent team. Finally dressed, coming up to bat in hard shoes and dress, right? Went up to bat, holding the bat down like this. Boom! The only parent for the day to hit a home run. Yeah. So he was good. He always supported us, you know. That's my part there.
So as we gather here today, we not only reflect on Dad's remarkable journey, but also on the profound impact that he had on each of our lives. His unwavering determination, warm heart, and infectious laughter endured him to all who knew him. Dad's legacy lives on, and in the cherished memories we hold dear, serving as a poignant reminder to embrace each day with courage and resilience. May you rest in peace, knowing that your journey has left an indelible mark on many lives, leaving behind a legacy of love and resilience that will be cherished from generations to come. Though we bid farewell, your spirit will forever reside in our hearts, guiding us through life's trials and triumphs. We celebrate your life and take solace in knowing that your legacy will endure through the lives that you touched and generation and the love that you shared. Thank you, Dad, for your countless lessons that you imparted on the boundless love and the boundless love that you showered upon us. Goodbye until we meet again. Thank you, Dad.
I'll do that. So anybody who's gone through this knows that memories matter. Thank you.
It's not that type of movie.
That wasn't supposed to happen.
As I was saying, you know, we know that memories matter, right? And it was a cousin of mine that told me that. And I really understand what she meant by that. As I'm going through this over the last few weeks, people were telling me about their memories of our father, and hearing them actually makes me feel a lot better. What we have done in the program, there's an area that has an email address. It's pete@orangehill.ca. If you can, please just type out, send a video of your memories of our father so that we have those to cherish. We can share them with you as well if you want, but we would like to see that, and that will warm our hearts. Thank you. Again, it's in the program. The email address to send it to is pete@orangehill.ca. All right. Thank you.
I will now have a video tribute followed by the hymn, How Great Thou Art.
Find me, but they told me can fight till the end, but I'm only human.
Is that about a new toy that's messing about? Nothing strange here. Everything is okay. See you later. Bye.
If you are able, please rise as we sing How Great Thou Art.
I hear the voice.
invite you to please remain standing as we confess our faith with the Apostles' Creed. Let us confess the faith of our baptism as we say, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now I invite you to please be seated for our prayers of the people.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you have knit your chosen people together in one communion in the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Give to your whole church in heaven and on earth your light and your peace. Hear us, Lord. May all who have been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection die to sin and rise to newness of life. And may we with him pass through the grave and gate of death to our joyful resurrection. Let us grant to us who are still in our pilgrimage and who are as yet by faith, that your Holy Spirit may lead us in holiness and righteousness all our days. Hear us, Lord. Grant to your faithful people pardon and peace, that we may be cleansed from all our sins and serve you with a quiet mind. Hear us, Lord. Grant to all who mourn a sure confidence in your loving care, and casting all their sorrow on you, they may know the consolation of your love. Hear us, Lord. Give courage and faith to those who are bereaved, that they may have strength to meet the days ahead in the comfort of a holy and certain hope, and in joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love. Hear us, Lord. Grant us grace to entrust Abraham Pete Millar to your never-failing love which sustained him in this life. Receive him into the arms of your mercy and remember him according to the favor you bear for your people. Hear us, Lord. We have the Lord's Prayer. I know as our Savior Christ has taught us, as we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
I invite you to please rise for the commendation. We say together, Give rest, O Christ, to your servants with your saints, where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing, but life everlasting. You only are immortal, the creator and maker of all, and we are mortal, formed of the earth, and to earth shall we return. For so did you ordain when you created me, saying, You are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust, yet even at the grave, we make our song, Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. Give rest, O Christ, to your servants with your saints, where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing, but life everlasting. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Abraham. Acknowledge, we pray, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, and a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. Amen. And a blessing for all of you gathered here today. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you this day, be with you these days ahead, and remain with you forevermore. Amen. And if you are able, I invite you to please remain standing for our recessional hymn today, It Is Well With My Soul.
Thank you. ladies and gentlemen, we'll now proceed to Glenview Memorial Gardens. It's located at 7541 Highway 50. I thought the directions we were going to be taking today was Goreway to Steeles and so forth, but I realized that the bridge is being built here, so we can't get through on Goreway. So the alternative, I think, is could be easier to make a right-hand turn on Goreway Drive. We'll go down to Derry Road, make another right, Airport, another right, follow that to Steeles, another right, and then we'll make ultimately our left-hand turn at Highway 50, and the cemetery's just up on the right-hand side. Folks, you're all welcome to come. I would just ask those who are driving, if you could just put your four-way flashers on. We'll try to get funeral flags on each one of your cars. I know there's kind of cars everywhere. We'll try to do our best there, but as long as you at least just put your four-way flashers on, that'll be a little bit easier for us all to stay together. At the conclusion of the service at cemetery, you're all welcome to join the members of the family at the Rizzo Banquet Hall, which is real close to the cemetery. It's 1941 Albion Road, which is right at, what's the street there called again? Humberline, yes, Humberline, right at the corner there. And it's actually right across the sister cemetery of Glenview, which is Glendale Memorial Gardens, which is just right across the street from there. Again, you're all welcome there too as well. Thank you.
Oh, walk to the door.